Topper, A Ghostly Adventure by Thorne Smith, narrated by John Rayburn. Here is a meeting with George and Marion Kerby, a couple of freewheeling ghosts who meet up with respectable banker Cosmo Topper. This was noted by the New York Times, claiming Thorne Smith created the modern American ghost story, ghosts with style and wit, ghosts that haunt us still. Others pointed out Smith was a master of urbane wit and sophisticated repartee. The overall mood has a touch of silliness, but it provides lighthearted reading and listening, a matter of nonsensical escapism. For Topper, it meant relief from a nagging wife with ongoing indigestion. Smith himself was a heavy drinker and died of a heart attack at a youthful 42. Once, after an unexplained week-long disappearance, he was asked why he hadn't called in sick, and he replied, "The telephone was in the hall, and there was a draft." Shall we listen to the escapades? Well, why not? Chapter 1, No Change. For some minutes now, Scollops had been gazing searchingly at Mr. Topper, and Mr. Topper was troubled, not definitely troubled, but vaguely so, which to some persons is the most troublesome form of trouble. Mr. Topper was one of such persons. In fact, he was highly representative of the type. So free from trouble had Topper's days been that gradually he had come to regard with suspicion all creatures not likewise unencumbered. An earthquake, an eruption, or tidal wave would mildly move Cosmo Topper, arouse him to the extent of a dollar donation which would later be deducted from his income tax, whereas a newspaper story dealing with bankruptcy, crimes of violence, or moral looseness would cause him speedily to avert his eyes to less disturbing topics. Mr. Topper could excuse nature and the Republican Party, but not man. He was an institutional sort of animal, but not morbid, not apparently anyway, so completely and successfully had he inhibited himself that he verily believed he was the freest person in the world. But Mr. Topper could not be troubled. His mental process ran safely, smoothly, and on the dot along well-signaled tracks, and his physical activities, such as they were, obeyed without question an inelastic schedule of suburban domesticity. He resented being troubled, at least he thought he did. That was Mr. Topper's trouble, but at present he failed to realize it. He experienced now something of the same resentment that came to him upon being delayed in the tunnel on his way home from the city. Things were going on around him in the tunnel, dreadful things, perhaps, but he did not know what they were. He sat in a blaze of light in the midst of clanking darkness. Surrounded by familiar things, he felt stuffy and uncomfortable. Even his newspaper lost its wonted stability. Yes, it was decidedly objectionable feeling that Mr. Topper had tonight, as he gave himself to the solicitous embrace of his armchair and followed with a dull gaze the rug's interminable border design, a Doric motif, clean-cut and geometrically accurate. Once this design had appealed to his abiding sense of order, tonight he hardly saw it, although without his knowledge it was wearying his eyes and had been doing so for several months. In Scollop's eyes, there was an expression difficult to fathom. Mr. Topper held the opinion that the expression was uncomfortably insinuating, making him in some sly way an accessory before the fact. But, hang it all, what was the meaning of Scollop's look? The cat had been fed. He had seen to that himself as he had seen to it ever since he had adventurously brought her home from Wilson's the grocer's one evening 4 years ago. 4 years, as long as that in this house, and once it had seemed so new. Now it was an old house, an uninteresting house. Perhaps he was old too and equally uninteresting. Mr. Topper felt that he was, and for the first time in his life permitted himself to wonder about such things. His intellectual debauchery was rudely shattered by Scollops. The cat yawned and tentatively thrust her nails into her benefactor's thigh. It was rather a plump thigh. Long years of sedentary work had served to despoil it of its youthful charm. It was a tight thigh and a fleshy one, yet it still reacted to pain, to such an extent, in fact, that Mr. Topper's sensation of trouble instantly gave one to one of mild reproach as he dropped scallops softly thudding to the floor. This faint discord in the domestic tranquillity caused Mrs. Cosmo Topper to look up from her needlework. Mr. Topper, glancing across the table, met his wife's eyes. It was just for a moment, then he looked quickly away, but why, he did not know. "She yawned," he remarked by way of explanation. "Yawned and scratched? I know it," apologized Mrs. Topper, mistaking his words for a direct accusation. "I've been doing it all evening. It must have been the veal." Topper watched his wife remove her sewing glasses and place them in their case. With an absorbed gaze, he followed her movements as she...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.